بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. إن شاء الله we have the session from 2 to 3 o'clock إن شاء الله, because العصر is at 3:15. And then after العصر إن شاء الله المغرب. Before we talk about the wudu and the basics of the wudu, we continue briefly with some of the principles. And the reason that we talk about some principles and matters of fiqh is not to learn them all, but also to understand that this religion is not something that people think that you can, a person can just open the book and make up opinions and things like that. No, there are principles and things that the people of knowledge, they looking in the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, they make these principles based on the Qur'an and the Sunnah. Not that they make the principle first and then they try to see how things is in the Qur'an and the Sunnah, but the principles are basically from the Qur'an and the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, and it makes it easy for the person to retain the knowledge and to keep it and to be able to use it whenever he is in need of it. And before we were talking about a principle in matters of fiqh, which is called, or ta'ama they call it, al-mashaqqa tajlub al-taysir, that hardship or difficulty would bring ease. And this does not mean that once a person has a matter of difficulty in making an act of worship of ibadah, that he would just choose to make it easier for himself by following his desires, or would make it easy. No, it's all by the rules of the religion. In the religion, in the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, we have the means of ease. And we talked about the different types of rukhas. The different types of rukhsa is basically a break, that you have the order of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in such a way, but in certain situations, in certain conditions, this can be relieved. A person can do it in an easier manner so that he will be able to perform the salah. And we talked about the rukhas, or these breaks are seven types, and it's good to remember them if a person needs them, although it has so much details to it that this is not the time to go through these details. First, we said that tarkhis al-isqat, as they call it, in which the whole act of worship, it is not mandatory for the person to do. And the example of this, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not make, for example, the Jum'ah prayer obligatory for women. So women, it's something that is optional for them. If they want to do it, mashallah, there's no problem in that. But it's not an obligation on them, it's an obligation on the men. So this is a break. This is something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would relieve the woman from that completely. And there are many examples. The second one that we said is tarkhis al-tanqis, or something that would be less. For example, a person would make the 4 rak'ah that he's supposed to make of dhuhr, al-asr, al-isha. If he's traveling, he would make it only 2. And this is the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, and this is the best way for a person to do if he's traveling, with the rulings of traveling, which is another subject, right? But this is the way of the Prophet ﷺ. For someone to say, well, if I'm traveling, it's easy for me, I can make the dhuhr 4 rak'ah, right? We do not take the religion by this. We take the religion by the way of the Prophet ﷺ. And the best way is the way of the Prophet ﷺ. So this is not just a break that a person can leave. No, this is the way of the Prophet ﷺ. And even some of the ulama, they made it obligatory for the person when he's traveling to make the salah, which is 4, to make it 2. Of course, if the person is praying behind an imam and the imam is completing his salah, then he should follow the imam and make it 4 rak'ah. And again, this is ruling that needs so much details too. So this is the second type of rukhsa or tarkhis. The third one that we talked about is they call it tafisul ibdal, meaning that you change it from one to the other. Like, for example, kafara, expiation of one's oath. You would find that if you make an oath about something that you want to do in the future and you're not able to do it, right, then you have to make an expiation. This expiation is in order, feeding 10 people. If you're not able to do that, and this is the break, if you're not able to do that, you won't be like a sinner, right? You have a break, and that is to fast 3 days. You feed 10 people or you clothe them. If you're not able to do that, then you fast 3 days. They don't have to be consecutive, but you have to fast the 3 days, if you're not done, you can free a slave. So this is another type of rukhsa, that one thing is changed to the other. We talked about number four, tarkhis al-taqdeem, that's something that you would do it ahead of time. It is not permissible for us now to make asr khair, right? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that the salah كانت على المؤمنين كتابا موقوتا. It's in prescribed times. We cannot make fajr now and isha later and so on. It has to be in the prescribed times that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered us. And this is a sign of a person being a slave of Allah. We submit ourselves to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered us to do. But in certain cases, we can do the salah earlier. This is the taqdeem. This is the break of the taqdeem. If a person is traveling, for example, and it's easier for the person, he leaves his home before dhuhr, and he's a traveler, and he would reach his destination, for example, after maghrib. So he has to pray dhuhr and asr on the way. So he can combine the two salah according to the correct opinion of the ulama, either at the time of dhuhr or at the time of asr. If it's at the time of dhuhr, this is the taqdeem. This is that you do it earlier, right? And if a person would do it at the time of asr, this is the ta'khir. Which one should the person choose? The sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ is what easier for the person to do. This is the mercy of Allah, right? So the easier way for the person to do is, this is the way of the Prophet ﷺ, whether it's at the time of dhuhr, so this is taqdeem. If it's ta'khir, this is the fifth one, and that is to do it later. Or, for example, and this is also a valid situation here, is that if a person is in a surgery, if a person, a doctor, for example, right? And this is also another important thing. If a person is in a certain profession, he needs to know what is the boundaries and what's the rules of Islam that deals with this profession. So if a person is a surgeon, for example, right? And he has a long surgery, and it's in the winter time, and he would enter the surgery room before dhuhr, and he would leave after maghrib. Most of the people, what do they do? Allah is the most forgiving, so they leave the salah. That's a dangerous situation, right? It's not permissible for a person to do that. So he has to know the ruling of this. So although he's not traveling, right? In that case, it's a necessity. If he leave the patient in there, he would die, right? And we're ordered to save lives. So in that case, it's permissible for him to combine the salah, either at the time of dhuhr or at the time of asr. So this is taqdeem or ta'khir. But can we open the door then? The person is going shopping, and it's winter time, right? And it's going to take a while. Can we just pray dhuhr and asr together in the time of dhuhr or the time of asr or maghrib or isha? This is of course not permissible. And especially for the sisters, some of them, they would take the matter easy, you know, and they would say, how can we pray in public, right? And we make sujood and things like that. The time of the salah, if you're not traveling, you have to make the salah. There is no excuse. So if you leave your home before maghrib, and you know that you're going to come back after Isha, you have to make arrangements to make the Maghrib at time of Maghrib, to make the Isha at time of Isha. It is a major sin to intentionally leave the Salat till the time of it is finished. Right? So we have to make sure that it's done on its prescribed time. How can we do it? Then this is another matter. We can discuss how to do it. Right? Go to a certain place in the back of the room, in a room, in a fitting room, anything. But she has to make the salah. If she's not able to make the salah standing after taking the means, not to choose the other option, but after taking the means, and she's not able to make the salah standing, because salah standing, the fard is mandatory for both men and women. If she's not able to do that, then she can pray sitting. Not to choose from the start to pray sitting. And this is also another thing, for a person clothing, if it's proper, in a lot of cases, making the sujood is not a problem, right? But because sometimes the clothing is not proper, so we need to make sure that the clothing is according to the way of the Prophet ﷺ. But this is also another issue. So this is a break here, that a person can make the salah earlier or later, and this is the taqdeem and the dakhir. Also, there is rukhsa or a break, which comes with the meaning of taghyir. Taghyir is changing. Changing something which is different than the one that we mentioned earlier. Meaning changing the way the ibadah is done. Changing the way the ibadah is done. What is the example of that? Salatul Khawf. Salatul Khawf is the salah of fear in the time of war. And the army supposed to make the salah. And they make it even in Jama'ah to show the importance of Salatul Jama'ah. These people are fighting for a good cause, for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is verses in the Quran. And the time for the Salah comes, can they say, well, we're doing something for the good cause? We can just neglect the Salah now. Or we pray it individually and we don't have to do the Salah. It is not permissible for them. They have to make the Salah. How do they make it? They make it in Jama'ah. And there are many forms of it. And it's mentioned in the Quran. One of these forms is that the Imam would lead a group of them. And the rest of them are guarding, facing the enemy. And when they finish one rak'ah, the Imam finished one rak'ah. We're not getting into the details of this, but just briefly. The Imam finished one rak'ah, they're praying with him, right? He stands to the second rak'ah, and they're behind him in the second rak'ah, right? Then they should separate themselves from the Imam with their intention. So they make ruku' on their own, each person on his own. Now they left the Imam with their intentions, they're not in Jama'ah anymore. And the Imam is standing in the second rak'ah, right? But the people behind him, they would recite the Fatiha on their own, making ruku' on their own, as if they are individual. And they finish the Salah on their own, and they leave. And the second group, those who were guarding, they come and they stand behind the Imam, and the Imam still standing in the second rak'ah, right? And the first group would take their positions of guarding, and the Imam still in the second rak'ah, they pray behind him and they say Allahu Akbar, and they follow him. Then the Imam would make the ruku' and the sujood and the tashahud, and when he makes salah, they get up and make the rak'ah that is missed, right? So this is one of the forms of it. Here the salah is changed. There is a change here in the salah. Did they make this change based on their desires? Of course not. This is mentioned in the Quran. This is the practice of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But this change, right, shows the importance of the Salatul Jama'ah. This is one of the evidences that the ulama they take to show that Salatul Jama'ah is an obligation on the men. Why? Because if it wasn't an obligation, it would have been easier that everybody pray on their own and that's it. Right? But to make sure that they're making Jama'ah, the rules of the Salah has been changed. So this is a break here. If they're not able to do that, the war is going on, and they're running left and right, should they leave the Salah? No. What do they do then? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, فَرِجَالَ وَرُكْبَانَ, meaning either you're walking, you're riding, you make your Salah. You're running, you make your Salah, and you make your Iman, you move your head for ruku' and you move your head for sujood, and as if you're in the tashahud and you're saying the tashahud. To that extent, it is not permissible to leave the Salah. And this is something that it's mandatory knowledge for us to know. A person gets sick and he goes to the hospital, and he's laying in the bed in the hospital. A lot of Muslims, they neglect the Salah. And they were people that are very caring about the Salah when they're not sick. But they think, well, they're carrying, for example, najasa, a bag of najasa, bag of impurity they have with them, right? And they cannot go into the bathroom and make wudu, and nobody's helping them. So they would say, Allah is the most forgiving, so they leave the Salah out of not knowing the ruling here. Okay, is it permissible for them? It's not permissible. What to do? If it's severe sickness, they can combine. But if it's not a severe sickness, somebody should help them. If they're not able to make the wudu, then if, and this is, we put so many lines under if they're not able, then they can make tayammum. If they don't have any means to make the tayammum, and the salah time comes, and the salah time will finish, and there's nobody there for them to help them, they have najasa, and they're not in state of wudu, should they abandon the salah? No, they pray in that same state that they are in. And this is a famous case that you would find it in the book of Fiqh. They call it Salat Faqid al-Tahurain, the prayer of the one that has no of the two kinds of Tahara. No water, no tayammum. Even the dust, he cannot find it. What should he do? Wait? No, make the Salah in whatever state he's in. And he does not have to repeat the Salah either, because he did it to the best of his capability. That means what? The rule is, there is no excuse of leaving the Salah. No excuse in leaving the Salah whatsoever. Men, women, it doesn't make a difference. A person has to make the Salah on time. But there is a rukhsah here in which it was changed in Salat al-Khawf. The last type, which is the seventh type, which is all well known to us, rukhsat lil-tarar, or al-tarura, necessity, life or death, right? And a person has to eat the haram, because either he eat the haram or he will die. Either he would say the word of kufr, or they have a sword on his neck that they would kill him. In that case, it's permissible for him to say the word of kufr, right? As long as his heart is settled with iman. A person can eat the meat of pork when, if there is such a case that he's about to die, there's no food, there's nothing, and unless he eats, this is what in his mind, there is no way, unless he eats this piece of haram meat, he will die. In that case, it becomes mandatory for him to eat what is enough to sustain his life. Not to eat and to fill his belly and things like that, but what's enough to fulfill or to sustain his life, which is something mentioned in the Quran. So, what is this necessity? We need to understand that, and that's why the common person should ask the people of knowledge. And when people do not or undermine the value of the people of knowledge, people make their own fatwas. And this is such a dangerous situation. Somebody driving an old car, and he has so much difficulty going back and forth to work, right? And sometimes he's late for work and he has to fix the car. The day off that he has to be the mechanic fixing his car. So he says, well, this is a necessity for me. I have to have a decent car. So what do? I go take a loan with riba, with usury. And he thinks that this is a necessity. It's not a necessity. This is not darura. This is haja, which is a lesser level. Yes, you have hard time. You have difficult time. But difficult time that does not cause definite death or major destruction, it is not permissible in that case to commit sins. Even if it's a small sin. Person has to be patient with the orders of Allah. Right? So we have to differentiate between the two. So the rukhsa here, the break here, in matters of darura, life and death situation, major destruction, and the ones that would give the verdict in this, knowing the rules of the sharia and everything, is the people of knowledge, and each person has his own situation. We have to be careful with the issues of the fatwa. Somebody going asking the sheikh, and he gave him the question, that if I don't get, or if I don't this haram, don't do this haram, I will die, my children will be orphans, that they would be disbelievers. For example, imagine that this was the question. And the alim is saying that if this is the case, then you can do this. Right? The people take the answer and they put different questions in it. That means it's permissible to deal with usury. Because the fatwa was given to one person versus the other, and this is a dangerous situation. Right? So the person has to be careful. This is the deen of Allah. This is what we have been created to observe and to fulfill the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So these are the seven types of rukhas or breaks, which just give us an understanding that this deen is mateen, it's a strong religion. It's something that is not to be taken lightly. It's something that we created to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. So we have to have the concern and to learn and to abide by the orders of Allah. And it's easy. If a person would seek the pleasure and the patience from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the matter would be easy for him. الخامسة رخصة التغيير. السادسة التغيير. الخامسة التأخير.
التأخير.
So the first one is رخصة الإسقاط. The matter is cancelled completely. The second one is called the تنقيس. Something is less, done in less numbers of ركعات, for example. The third one, الإبدال, that you exchange one for the other, like the كفارة, the expiation. Number four, the تقديم, making it earlier. The تأخير, you make it later. Number six, you something changed in the ibadah, like the fear prayer. And number seven is darura, the break at times of darura, or times of extreme necessity. One more condition, or one more principle, and there are many. Again, there are books just for the qawa'id al-fiqhiyya, the principles of fiqh. Right? And this is not, again, done by desires, it's done based on what's in the Quran and the authentic sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And any student of knowledge, anyone, he has to have these principles, and we have usul fiqh and everything. And this can never be studied unless the person masters the language of the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, because it has linguistics. When the Prophet ﷺ orders, and the verb is in the order tense, what does that mean? Right? Does that mean that it's mandatory to be done? And when it's mandatory and when it's not mandatory, right? And this understanding has to come when the person would understand the language and study the deen and how it was transformed from one generation to the other. No making brand new things, but it's basically taking this religion from one generation to the other, from the people of knowledge, those who has this religion since the time of the Prophet ﷺ. One important principle that we need to have, especially in wudu and salah, that we need it. And this principle is al-yaqeen la yazuru bil-shak. Al-yaqeen meaning what? Certainty. Right? And when we talk about yaqeen, it's usually a deed done by the heart, and it has some form of increasing the iman and softening the heart, right? But here the yaqeen meaning certainty is not removed by doubt. Certainty You do not change your certainty by doubt. What does that mean in matters of fiqh? You know for sure that you are in state of wudu. For sure, no doubt about it. Right? And you are in the salah. And then something happened in your stomach, you're in doubt whether you broke your wudu or not. The certainty is what? That you have wudu. The doubt is whether you broke your wudu or not. What to do in this case? Certainty is not to be changed. That means you stay in the salah. You do not leave the salah if you are in doubt. How did they, where did they get this principle from? From the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ. The Prophet ﷺ clearly said in the authentic hadith, إِذَا شَكَّ أَحَدُكُمْ فِي صَلَاتِهِ. If one of you had doubt in his salah, whether he broke his wudu or not, and there's another narration that some of us said has issues in its authenticity, he said that the shaitan, there's no shyness in the religion, shaitan blow in the back of you, in the bottom of a human being during the salah, to make him feel that he passed air. Right? So the person will have doubt whether he broke his wudu or not. The Prophet ﷺ clearly said, if this is the case, do not leave your salah unless you hear a sound or you smell something. That means what? That means the certainty is changed by another certainty. If a person hears the sound of breaking the wudu or smells something, that means this is a certain thing. That means he needs to leave the salah and go make the wudu. But if he doesn't hear something, doesn't smell something, and he's in doubt, it is not permissible for him not to say, well, it's better for me, it's okay, I can go make wudu and come and be in the safe side, and this is something good desires. The Prophet ﷺ said something, we have to submit ourselves. This is Rasulullah ﷺ. And the goal is not just to make it easy for us, this is the deen of Allah. And why? Because if a person opened this door and disobeyed the Prophet ﷺ in this, he would lead himself to some mental sicknesses. And we know the disease, right? What is it called?
Excessive
compulsion. Right? When the person opens this door, then he go make wudu. And the next time, shaitan gets stronger. The doubt becomes more. Oh, you broke your wudu. He's an easy target now. He will leave the salah, go make wudu. Then he's making the wudu. And while he's making the wudu, oh, did I wash my arm properly? Did I wash my face? Or after the wudu, or maybe I broke the wudu or not? And you find this person after some time, the whole day in the washroom, making wudu. Some people are like this, always wet. And they come to the salah and they leave, and then it becomes a chemical issue and they have to take medicine. And it's a major problem. And this is the whisper of the shaitan to those who love the deen. If a person is away from the deen, he has other ways for him. You come to the masjid, you want to make the salah, the shaitan won't come and tell you, drink wine, go commit sins and this and that in the masjid. But he will come to you from the ibadah and from being very careful. But being very careful without knowledge, that can take the person astray. So the order of the Prophet ﷺ is, whether it makes sense to us or not, this is the submission that we have to have to the saying of the Prophet ﷺ. Do not leave your salah unless you become certain. What if a person did not hear anything and did not smell anything, but he is certain? What should he do? He should leave the salah. But how can he know that he's certain and not? To make it easier to understand, Abdullah ibn Mubarak, rahimahullah, one of the early generation of Islam, the imma of his deen, one of the narrators of Sahih al-Bukhari, a famous scholar in the deen, Abdullah ibn Mubarak, rahimahullah, he said with regard to this, if you're able to say, Wallahi, the one that is, no one is worthy of worship, no one is worthy of worship except him, I broke my wudu, then leave. If you are in this level where you're able to say that, right? Then leave the salah, cut the salah. So if this happens to you in the salah, ask yourself, is it that level of certainty? I can say, Wallahi, I broke my wudu. Right? If a person cannot say that, of course we don't have to say it physically, right, in the salah, but the attitude is, if you're not in this level of certainty, then it's not permissible for you to break the salah and go repeat it. Why? Because of this hadith, and from this hadith the principle is, certainty is not to be changed by doubt. الحديث إذا شك أحدكم في صلاته فلا ينصرف فلا ينفتل من صلاته حتى يسمع صوتا أو يجد ريحا. He should not leave the salat till he smells something or he hears something. And many other principles, and maybe this is something that can be a subject of just talking about some of these principles in matters of fiqh. It makes things clearer to the person. Now if we talk about wudu, we have half an hour till the salat. بعض الله we have the situation okay طيب نعم for the sisters inshallah I was planning there was a PowerPoint made by someone else and it had pictures and things like that for the sisters to see exactly how the matter to be done but forgive me it's my fault I did not have the time to do that so in that case there is a sister inshallah in the back I'm explaining how to make wudu and she would do it to the sisters with her as if she's making wudu in front of them and I would say it in the sentence in Arabic and then explain it in English inshallah ta'ala but before we talk about how to make the wudu to understand how the matters in the book of fiqh is or the knowledge of fiqh the wudu is a condition for the salah right salah is not valid unless we have wudu wudu comes from wada'a from goodness from brightness right and in the deen the wudu is means that we have to do wash ourselves in a certain way with the intention that we are relieving ourselves from al-hadath from being in a state we cannot perform the salah when you make wudu if you are in state of wudu that means you can make the salah you can make tawaf around the Kaaba you can hold the Quran and read and so on right so if this is the wudu we make wudu with something and that is water so the ulama they talked about the conditions of the water to be used this water has to be pure has no any impurities in it and this is another subject again the matter is so many different things of course but because of the time we just concentrating of how to make wudu but one topic is what is the purity of the water alhamdulillah we open the tap water we have water alhamdulillah this is pure even if it has chemicals in it but if the water is impure by anything that would change its color or the smell or the taste one of these three things are changed by an impurity not changed by a pure thing changed by impurity what are the impurities something that is mentioned in the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam right and this is another topic also if it's one of these three things quality characteristics of the water was changed and you're making wudu for example from a bucket then you cannot use this water if the smell or the color or the taste of it changed by an impurity so for example if you have a huge bucket of water and a drop of impurity say urine for example fall into this bucket nothing has been changed in it nothing as a result of this has been changed the color is not changed a bit the smell is not changed and the taste is not changed is it permissible to make wudu from this big bucket yes because nothing has been changed and this is according to the guidelines of the ulama and we don't have to get into the details of this but anyway so the subject of what we make wudu with is water we cannot make wudu with juice for example it has to be water right and the water in its original form we make the wudu how do we make the wudu and I think that the sheet that you have or the different things that we talk about it has it mentions water this is a subject to be dealt with utensils if we don't have tap water and you make wudu from utensils from a bucket can it be anything no if it's made of gold and silver we cannot make wudu from it and the prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam forbade us from doing so forbade us from drinking
gold
and silver and drinking from these things if it's made of diamond it's okay I mean just to exaggerate the matter right but the thing is what the prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam only said and other rulings with regarding to the utensils because the ulama they talked about it because this is where the water is contained in also they talk about impurities before they talk about the wudu and what are the impurities it's also mentioned in the book of Allah and the sunnah of the prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam but very briefly also anything that comes out of impurities of the human being like the urine his throw up if it's come from the stomach right the blood if it's gushing out blood is not an impurity according to the correct opinion but if it's gushing out so much then that's something that will break the wudu the menses blood the blood of menses and the blood after birth bleeding for women al-wadi which is the fluid that comes out from the person after urinating to some of them if a person is sick or or he lifts heavy weight, sometimes a thick white drop might come out. This is impure. Al-madan, also a transparent fluid that is usually the person won't feel it, that comes out as a result of sexual desire, right? And this is not where the human being is made from, which is a seminal fluid. This is the madan that comes before that. It's also impure. And al-mayta, something that died without being slaughtered, you know, died by natural causes or whatever there is, except of course fish and locusts, it's permissible. The flesh and the meat of pork is impurity. The urine and the droppings of the animals that is not permissible for us to eat is impure. That is not permissible for us to eat. So for example, the urine of a goat is pure. Somebody would say, well, what are you talking about here? It's pure, what do you mean by pure? Meaning if it comes on your clothing, of course everybody will clean it. But we're talking here about matter of the salah. Can you make the salah if it's on your clothing? Yes, you can. Right? We're not talking about cleanliness here, we're talking about the najasa that is clearly mentioned that would prevent you from making the salah. So the urine of something that is not permissible for us to eat, like donkeys and things like that, that's impure. And the saliva of the dog, right, it's also impure. If it comes on one's clothing, it is enough for the person to wash it. If it comes into the utensils or a bowl or a plate, the Prophet ﷺ said, ordered to be washed 7 times, the first time with dust. And again, this is something that has details and evidence and so on. But this is in brief. So this is impurities. Now, we want to talk about the wudu. And again, if we say that we already know how to make wudu, because it's a mandatory thing on every Muslim. If you know, mashallah, it's good. But if your knowledge comes from since you were a small child, this is something that we need to review. Why? Because it's good that the Muslim get to know the matters of ibadah based on evidences, so that the more, once he making wudu, he have in his mind that this is to the best of my capability, this is the way of the Prophet ﷺ. This is, he did that. So you get more reward when you're doing it. It does not become a habit or a cultural thing or whatever there is. It becomes part of the ibadah that we do. When we make wudu, the ulama, they talk about pillars, arkan, and recommended acts, and disliked acts, and the things that breaks the wudu. And why do they classify the different things here in wudu? Not so that if it's an optional thing, we leave it. No, but they classify these things so that if you miss something in wudu, what do you need to do? Do you need to repeat the wudu again, or your wudu is fine? So when we talk about wudu, we should not talk first about pillars and recommended and dislikes. We should talk about how to perform the wudu perfectly. And this is what we do, right? And this is what we would do at all times. Unless the person would miss something, he needs to know that. Or if he has to miss something, then he needs to know if he's missing a pillar or recommended act and so on, right? So the perfect wudu to be done, سأبدأ إن شاء الله بالكلام عن الوضوء, the way the Prophet ﷺ used to do it, and some issues has differences of opinion, but we'll talk inshallah in brief, according to the most correct opinions based on the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ. The Prophet ﷺ كان يبدأ الوضوء بأن يقول بسم الله. صفة الوضوء أن يبدأ فيقول بسم الله. So the Prophet ﷺ used to start by saying Bismillah. So that I don't forget anything. So we keep the order in place. So before he says Bismillah, the intention is in the heart, right? And we talked yesterday about some of the principles and the methodology that we understand. The Deen of Islam. Because maybe the better is given. No? Turn it off. But I think this is where the speaker for the sisters is. Is this clear for the sisters? There's no echoing? It's not clear? It's clear. So the intention has to be there first, because we make wudu in a specific manner. If a person cleans himself like this by any way, and he says, well, I clean myself, and say the wudu doesn't work. We have to have the intention that we're making wudu to be able to make salah or to go around the Kaaba and so on. This intention, is it something to be said by the tongue? This is a matter of worship. So we ask ourselves, did the Prophet ﷺ say, Nawaitu an atawadda? I have the intention to make wudu? The answer is no. And for those who say yes, he did, they need to bring the evidence, and there's no evidence. If any of the companions radiallahu anhum said, we have the intentions to make wudu, none of them said that. And there's not even one even fabricated hadith or anything like that that would say that a person has to say something of intention. The intention is something that is done by the heart. It's an action by the heart. The tongue has nothing to do with it. Some of the later ulama, yes, they said that as a way to help the people so that they don't forget. But the best way is the way of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He didn't choose to say it, so we do not say it. We should not introduce something in the religion that is not part of it. Right? We know what we're doing. And that's why if a person is about to eat, he does not say, Nawaitu, I have the intention to eat rice and meat. Right? He knows what he's doing. So when we make him wudu, nobody would make the actions of wudu like this by habit. He knows what he's doing. So it doesn't have to have the intention that we're making wudu for dhuhr, making wudu for asr, making wudu for nafl, or making wudu for sunnah. Doesn't matter. You make him wudu, you can make all of the different ibadahs with. Right? So the intention is in the heart. النِّيَّة مَحَلُّهَا الْقَلْبُ وَلَا تَلَفُّظَ فِيهَا ثُمَّ بَعْدَ ذَلِكَ يَبْدَأ بِالتَّسْمِيَّةِ. Say Bismillah. And Bismillah is good enough. Not to say Bismillah والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. Alhamdulillah is a good thing. Salah on the Prophet ﷺ is a virtuous thing. But if it was good at this moment, at this time, the Prophet ﷺ would have ordered us to do it. So since he did not say it, so we do not say it. Right? So we say Bismillah in the name of Allah, which we say it before anything that we do. Then after that, after saying Bismillah, we wash ثُمَّ يَغْسِلُ كَفَّيْهِ ثَلَاثًا. Then the person would wash his palm, his hands, from the tip of the fingers to the wrist, three times, right? And to make sure that the person is going with his fingers in between the fingers. وَيُخَلِّلْ بَيْنَ الْأَصَابِعِ يَغْسِلُ كَفَّيْهِ ثَلَاثًا وَيُخَلِّلُ بَيْنَ الْأَصَابِعِ. Washing the hands three times to the wrist, حتى الرزق, وَيُخَلِّلُ بَيْنَ الْأَصَابِعِ, and going with his fingers like this between the fingers. Everything I'm saying here, it is based on the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, not because it makes sense. This is how the Prophet ﷺ used to do and used to order. So this is the first thing, three times. We're not talking about pillars or recommended acts here, right? We're talking about someone making wudu. So he would do this three times. ثُمَّ يَتَمَضْمَضُ وَيَسْتَنْشِقُ مِنْ كَفٍ وَاحِدٍ. Then he would make the madmada, madmad, right? Which means you move the water in your mouth. And in the Arabic language, again, you get the feeling of what you're doing from hearing the voice of it. Right? When you hear mab mab, something is repeated. Right? So yata mab mab, meaning that the water is moving over and over in your mouth. So you put water in your mouth, and you move it in your mouth, gargling. And with the same handful of water, and this is in Sahih Bukhari, this is the perfect way. You put some in the mouth, and some, you would take it up into your nose. يَتَمَضْمَضْ وَيَسْتَنْشِقْ وَالِسْتِنْشَقْ هُوَ أَخْذِ الْمَاءِ إِلَىٰ أَعْلَىٰ الْأَنْفِ. That you would take some in the mouth, and you would inhale, right? The water into the top of your nose. You do this to it, right? But not to any choke or anything like that. So this is with one handful. If a person do it with two handfuls, it is better. But we're talking about the perfect way that the Prophet ﷺ used to make. So, and if you're not used to it, train yourself. It's easy, right? A person, if you do it, training himself, it becomes easy, and that's why we should use the least amount of water, not opening the water too much. And this is the way of the Prophet ﷺ. So from one handful, some of the water in the mouth, and taking the water up to the nose, this is with the right hand. نصف الغرفة لفمه ونصفها لأنفه. Half of it to the mouth and the rest to the nose. يفعل ذلك بثلاث غرفات. You do that in three handfuls of water. And then with the left hand you can blow your nose, right, to get the water out. Right? So this is with the madmada and the istinsha. Taken with one handful, some of the water in the mouth, then the rest in the nose, and with the left hand you can blow the nose. And inshallah we'll keep the questions at the end of your month.
You do that three times?
Three times. Now, again, this is just talking about one way. The Prophet ﷺ used to do it sometimes two times, sometimes one time. And it's all authentic hadith of the Prophet ﷺ. So it's part of the sunnah that sometimes you do it one time, sometimes you do it two times, sometimes you do it three times, but the most of the way of the Prophet ﷺ, most of your case at all times, is most of the time to make it three times. So this is three times for both mouth and the nose. ثُمَّ يَغْسِلُ وَجْهَهُ ثَلَاثًا ثُمَّ يَغْسِلُ وَجْهَهُ ثَلَاثًا. Then he would wash his face three times. وَالْغَسْرِ لَبُدَّ فِيهِ مِنْ جَرَيَانِ الْمَاءِ. We have to differentiate between washing and wiping. Washing meaning that the water has to run. Right? So you take some water in your both hands or so, and you put it on your face. Right? وَيُدَلِّكُ بِكِلْتَ يَدَيْهِ. And then you would rub with both of your hands so that the water reaches all the different parts of the face. What is the face? الْوَجْهِ هُوَ مَا تَوَجَّهْ بِهِ الْإِنسَانِ. What you face people. Right? And the limits of it is حَدِّ الْوَجْهِ مِنْ مَا يَنْبُتِ الشَّعْرِ عَادَةً. What usually the hair grows, not if someone doesn't have hair, then you start from his back, no. Where usually the hair grows, the hair grows, right? Till حَتَّى أَسْفَلْ الذَّقْ. Till the bottom of the shin. This is the face. This part is not from the face, right? Here. It's till أَسْفَلْ الذَّقْ. Till this lower part of the chin, and from both sides, from one side of the ear to the other side of the ear. So from the where the hair usually grows, من جانب الأذن إلى الجانب الآخر. So all of this is face, from where usually the hair grows to the bottom of the chin, and from one part of the ear where the ear starts till the other side. You know this area where it's right next to the ears. This is part of the face. If this is dry, then this is a problem. Some people, when we in our forehead, there is grooves, right? If a person is, if this is dry, this is a problem. فغضون الوجه لابد كذلك أن تغسل. That all the face has to be washed. And we do that three times, right? Person with a beard, and then I guess we'll have to say that in Arabic, right? A person with a beard. If the beard is light, then maybe the sisters that can teach the husbands. الرجل إذا كان ملتحب فإذا كانت اللحية خفيفة. If the beard is light, then the face has to be washed. Right? You can see the skin. But if the beard, you cannot see the skin, it is enough for the person to wash the outside. But the Prophet ﷺ, the perfect way is to كَنَا يُخَلِّلْ لِحْيَتَهُ. Meaning, تَخْلِيل here. What is تَخْلِيل meaning? That your fingers go into the thing. So it goes through the beard like this. The fingers are going through the beard. Right? You don't have to make sure that every single hair is wet. Right? As long as you take the sum of water and you put it on the face, and then you make the takhleel like this, that's good. Right? So this is one time. And you do it three times. Thalath, marat, the most perfect way. If a person do it two times, sometimes this is also good from the way of the Prophet ﷺ. ثم يغسل يده اليمنى مع المرفق ثلاثا. Then washing the hands till the مرفق. واليد تبدأ من أطراف الأصابع حتى وإن قد غسلت في غسل الكفين. ولكن الغسل الأول هذا مستحب. أما غسل يدي المرفقين فهذا واجب فرض. فلا بد أن يغسل أطراف الأصابع مرة أخرى. هذه قضية مهمة جدا. Here you have to wash again from the tip of your fingers. You already did it in the first time, right? But this first time, by the way, it's not one of the pillars of the wudu. This is a pillar of the wudu, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in the Quran. So it has to be washed again from the tip of your fingers, not from the wrists. And you say, well, the first, my hand, my palm is wet. No, this is pillar now. It has to be done in order. So you have to wash from the tip of the finger إلى المرفقين. المرفق is what? Is the elbow, right? And you go a little bit over. وَيَزِيد عَلَى الْمِرْفَقِينَ. So the mirfaq or the elbow, المرفق داخل في الوضوء. Not till the elbow. No, the elbow is part of it. If you wash just till the elbow and the elbow is not washed, the wudu is not valid. So you have to go over. And you see that people want to make wudu, sometimes they make their sleeves like this. Right? And the elbow is not showing. And they would wash, you know, just like that, and that's good enough. The wudu is not valid. Right? So the person has to make sure, you know, even if the shirt is wrinkled, inshallah, Allah would replace it by something better, inshallah. Right? So making it like this so that the water reaches the elbow and a little bit over, you know, and this is something that would come on the Day of Judgment where the person will be bright, as the Prophet said. He would know his ummah from the traces of wudu, from their faces and from their feet. And the Prophet said in the authentic hadith, when he was asked, how would you know your ummah? When there's so many people, how many individuals on the face of earth since Adam alayhi salam, in the Day of Judgment? He said alayhi salatu wassalam, imagine if there was horses that are totally dark, black, but they have whiteness in their forehead and in their foot. Would you know your horses? If these are your horses? He said, yes. He said, my ummah will come on the Day of Judgment with these brightness on their faces and on their ankles because of the traces of the wudu. So that means the one that does not make wudu, does not make salah, he's in a great danger, right? So this is something that we do with the arms all the way, and the elbow is part of it, and we go a little bit over. ثُمَّ يَغْسِلُ يَدَهُ الْيُمْنَ, the right hand first, from the top of the fingers all the way, one time, and then second time and third time. يَغْسِلْ يَعْنِ مَعَ جَرَيَانِ الْمَاءِ, washing meaning the water is running, not wiping. The water has to run. Does it have to run on every single part of the arm? No. If it runs, right, and then with the hand you're making the dalk, you're rubbing your hand all over the place of the arm, then you're okay. You do that three times. And the dalk is sunnah. The dalk is mustahab. Rubbing is recommended, it's not mandatory, right? And the technique, either you put hand in some water in your palm, إنسان يضع بعض الماء في كفه ثم يعني ينزل الماء على الذراع إلى المخ. Then he would let the water goes down and it drips like this, or by any means, but this is the way that we use less water as possible. So this is the right hand to the elbow and then the left one ثم اليسرى مثل ذلك. ثم يمسح رأسه بيديه مرة واحدة من مقدمه إلى قفاه ثم يردهما إلى الموضع الذي بدأ منه ثم يدخل سبابتيه في باطن أذنيه ويمسح بإبهاميه ظاهرهما. What does this mean? Then he would wipe. Here يمسح, not washing. So we do not bring water and then we do this. And if somebody would say, well, it's better, we would wash it. This is all using our desires. When it comes to to revelation, ibadah, we just do what the Prophet ﷺ did and what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered. So in that case, you let the water go down and you wipe from the beginning of your head all the way to the end, and then you come back with your hand still on your head till you come to the front again. Right? Somebody would say, enough, some part of it. We're talking about the perfect way here. Right? This matter has differences of opinion also. But to start from the beginning all the way to the end of the head. And then you come back again to the front. Right? With both hands. كَنَا يُقْبِلُ بِهِمَا وَيُدْبِرُ. The hadith says that the Prophet ﷺ used to do that with both hands, going forward and backward. Right? And if a person have a hairstyle and everything like that, also be patient so that you do it in the proper way. How about sisters? They do the same thing, but they don't. The wiping, المسح على الرأس وليس المقصود الشعر. المسح على الرأس. The wiping is for the head, not the hair necessarily. That means if a person doesn't have hair, does he leave this pillar of the wudu? No, of course he wipes his head. And the same thing if a person have a long hair, does he have to, or does she have to wipe the whole hair? No, it's the head, right? So she goes all the way to the end of the head, even if she has longer hair, it doesn't matter, you just go to the end of the head and then you come back. This is if she is in the comfort of her home and everything, mashallah, is easy. If the sister is outside and she's wearing the hijab and it's tight, and she cannot take it out and she's in a public place, in that case, the ulama, they say, it has the ruling of the imam. But as long as the hijab is tight. And the ruling of the imama is that she would go from underneath the hijab, just wipe a small part of the head from underneath the hijab, and then the rest of the head from on top of the hijab. The rest of the head on top of the hijab, and this is the perfect way. Right? So this is wiping the head back and forth. يبقى بالنسبة للنساء كانت تلبس الحجاب فتدخل اليد من تحت الحجاب فتمسح بعض الرأس ثم تكمل باقي المسح على الخمار من أعلى الخمار وهذا هو الأكمل. This is the perfect way. Again, if a person do part of the head according to the jumhur, the majority of the ulama, it's sufficient. But we're talking about the most perfect way to go back and forth. ثم يغسل رجله اليمنى مع الكعب ثلاثة. Then he would wash his right foot till the. Oh, I didn't say the yes. But I said it in the Arabic. It goes back and forth in the head, right? And with the same water, without putting your head down, you put your sababa. This is the sababa, the forefinger, inside of your ears, and it's going into the grooves. These passages inside of your ears, and with the ibham, which is the index finger, it's doing at the same time the back of your ear, the back of the ear. فالسبابة تكون في داخل الأذن والإبهام في ظاهر الأذن في خارج الأذن خلف الأذن at the same time. So the سبابة, and this is also the hadith of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. The سبابة, this finger that you move in the تشهد, goes inside the ear and it's moving, right? With the water that it has, it's all wiping, right? You start from the, of course, the mid side, and then it goes out. And at the same time, with the index finger, both of them, it's going to the back of the nose, the back of the ears, right? With the same water, that you wipe the head back and forth. So the way to do it, the person will do this, and then come back, and then goes to the ears, and he's doing this. With the index finger in the back, and the sababa, the forefinger inside. Oh, this is thumb? Oh, I'm sorry, this is index, right? I'm sorry. This is the index that you use in the tashahhud, and the thumb is the short, fat one, right? The thumb, right? You do it for the back of the ear, right? So, because if you're like me, you don't know what the difference between the thumb and then you have to have some more evidences. So this is with regarding to how to wipe the ears. Right? Then after that, we go to the foot, the right foot. We're talking here about the wudu of the Prophet ﷺ based on the evidences from the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. Somebody might tell me, what about the neck? Right? The neck has no authentic hadith to it. It has a weak hadith. Right? And the weak hadith, we do not build an action when it comes to it. So we go to the right foot. The right foot. The right foot, ثم يغسل رجله اليمنى مع الكعب. والكعب هو النتوء البارز الذي يفصل بين القدم وبين الساق. وليس الكعب هو العقب الذي يلمس الأرض. لا, وإنما الكعب هو النتوء البارز في جانب القدم الذي يفصل بين الساق وبين القدم. Washing the foot with the ankles, right? Till the end of the ankles, not the heels. The heels, of course, it's washed. But this is not the end of the foot. The foot, you have to go up a little bit higher till the ankles are washed. And you go a little bit more too because of the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ. So you just don't do just the ankles. This is, of course, the mandatory thing, but you go over a little bit. So, ثُمَّ يَغْسِلْ رِجْلَهُ الْيُمْنَى مَعَ الْكَعْبِ ثَلَاثًا. Is it clear? So this is with the foot, all the foot, the water is running on it, and you're مَعَ الْتَلْكِ, and you rub it with your hand, and the Prophet ﷺ said, وَيْلٌ لِلْأَعْقَابِ مِنَ النَّارِ. Woe to the heels from the half-height. Why? Because if the person doesn't have the concern, his heel will be dry. And he said that ﷺ, when he saw a man when they were making wudu, and a small portion of his heel was dry, that the sun reflected this thing, and it was big as one's fingernails. And the Prophet, that's small. And the Prophet ﷺ said, woe to the heels from the half-height. Because wudu is a condition of the salah that shows the person is concerned about the deen. So the heels has to be washed, and the ankles has to be washed all the way to the, and you go on top of it a little bit. And there is the authentic hadith in Sunan Abi Dawood and others with the small finger. What do you call this finger?
Pinky.
Pinky. Okay. With the, is that a real formal name or it's a, the little finger. A person would go in between the toes with the little finger. Right? The left one for both the right and the left foot. Right? And this is a sound hadith. Right? So you're washing the whole foot and with the small finger, between the toes. You're moving it between the toes. With the left hand. Al-yad al-yusra for both the right and the left foot. Right? So you do the right foot to the ankles and on top of it a little bit and then the left one. And once a person is finished, ثُمَّ يَدْعُوا كَمَا وَرَدْ. Then a person would make the dua as it's mentioned. What is the dua? A person would say after he finishes the wudu, أَشْهَدُ أَنْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ وَأَشْهَدُ أَنَّ مُحَمَّدًا عَبْدُهُ وَرَسُولُهُ. And this is what has been authenticated from the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. أَشْهَدُ أَنْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ وَحْدَهُ لَا شَرِيكَ لَهُ وَأَشْهَدُ أَنَّ مُحَمَّدًا عَبْدُهُ وَرَسُولُهُ. If he says that, the gates of Jannah will be opened for him to enter from it from whatever gate he wishes. In this hadith, he quoted by Imam Muslim to say, أَشْهَدُ أَنْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ وَحْدَهُ لَا شَرِيكَ لَهُ وَأَشْهَدُ أَنَّ مُحَمَّدًا عَبْدُهُ وَرَسُولُهُ. And there is an authentic narration after that. You say, اللَّهُمَّ اجْعَلْنِي مِنَ التَّوَّابِينَ وَاجْعَلْنِي مِنَ الْمُتَطَهِّرِينَ. Allah, make me among those who make tawbah constantly and make me among those who are pure. And there is an authentic one. مَنْ تَوَضَّأَ ثُمَّ قَالَ. Whoever make wudu and after that say, سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك لا إله إلا أنت أستغفرك وأتوب إليك. This is also good, and it will be written in a paper or in a sheet, as the Prophet ﷺ said, or a tablet. It would not be broken till the day of judgment. And this is a sound hadith reported by Imam Nasa'i and Al-Tabarani, and Sheikh Al-Bani rahimahullah said that it's a sound hadith. So the third one, سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك لا إله إلا أنت أستغفرك وأتوب إليك. And again, when we say the adhkar, we need to make sure that we're saying it with our hearts and our tongues to get the full rewards. Because if we really understand what is being said, then the reward is so great from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك. Saying that Allah is free from all deficiencies. And He is the one that is all praises to Him. That subhanallah, alhamdulillah, the one that has the perfect praise. And then He would say, لا إله إلا أنت. No one is worthy of worship except you. The word that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the heavens and the earth for. أستغفرك, Allah forgive me, cover my sins, do not punish me for my sins, وأتوب إليك, I repent to you, I return to you, and as a result of that, it's such a great reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is where the person would finish the wudu, right? We did not talk about pillars. Briefly, what are the pillars of wudu? What is mentioned in the verse in the Quran, right? But again, we do the whole thing like this, every time, according to the way of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. And now, if there's any questions, the prayer is 3:15, right? So 5 minutes only, so that people, if they want to make wudu, and then we continue after the asr. And if there's questions to the from the sisters also, we can try to answer it. Hadith? Now, بالنسبة لغسل ما بين أو ما بين الأصابع أصابع الرجلين فثبت في سنة النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام أن الإنسان كان يفعل ذلك بالإصبع الأصغر هذا من اليد فيخلل بين أصابع الرجلين يخلل بين أصابع الرجلين بإصبع اليد اليسرى اليمنى واليسرى.
Is it not necessary to put the three times in the nose like separately after the mouth?
Separately, if a person wants to do the mada first and then the nose, separately the wudu is valid. But again, we should train ourselves to do it together. Inshallah, you will get the rewards that this is something that the Prophet ﷺ used to do. But the other way, of course, the wudu is valid.
هل يجمع بين الحديث الثلاث التي بعد الوضوء وهل يرفع إصبعه ونظره إلى السماء؟